Recording. Okay. All right. And I'll just wait for anyone to pop in. Welcome, everybody. If you're popping in now, just have a virtual seat. Just going to wait a little bit for just to let everybody come in, and then we'll get started. Feel like at this stage, I should have music playing. I've never like really, I don't know,
Some nice
maybe,
elevator music or
yeah,
something.
just like a nice elevator vibe or something that people can like feel comfy. Alrighty, so why don't I get started? We are recording. It's a good enough time to do this, and if everyone pops in after, it'll be fun. All right, so greetings, people of the internet. Welcome to the fourth installment of the Fall 2023 Sara Little Turnbull Foundation Visiting Designer Speaker Series. That's quite a mouthful here at Lehman College. Thanks for joining us today. Again, if you've been with us for the last few talks, thank you for coming back as we continue to explore the gaze in art and design. Just a quick note about that topic. This lecture series is running concurrently with the exhibition in the Lehman College Art Gallery entitled Framing the Female Gaze. Excuse me, and it'll be open until January 20th of 2024. Today, it's my privilege to introduce our distinguished guest, Chloe Shepphard. Chloe's a multifaceted UK artist, known for her work as a photographer, filmmaker, writer. Currently, she's based just outside of London, where she's joining us from today. Her work delves into the nuanced conventions of beauty, emotion, and nostalgia. In 2020, Chloe co-founded the Fat Zine, although she stepped down after the second issue. And over the last 7 years, she has self-produced several zines showcasing her unique body of work. And beyond her creative pursuits, she's also a devoted lover of books, as am I, dedicating her time to an independent bookstore in Hertfordshire. Notably, Chloe also leads a monthly in-person reading group, a space for thoughtful discussions centered around books that explore themes of art, women, and identity. So with her diverse talents and her innovative perspective and her interest in these things, she is uniquely positioned to guide us to this exploration into this relationship between design and the gaze that we've been talking about this semester. So please welcome Chloe Shepherd. Chloe, thank you so much for meeting with us today.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to talk about, I don't know, work I haven't looked at for a while and just like get back into it a bit.
Yeah, it's always kind of cool to look at past work. Although I would mention that I was looking at your bio. You're born in 1996, which is when I graduated high school. So I'm feeling like I'm feeling we're talking about nostalgia. I'm feeling a little nostalgic for the 90s. I thought we would start by looking at some of your work. I'll just bring it up here. Let me know if you can if you can't see it. If you can't see it, I'll just full screen it here. And actually, let me show the contact sheet. So I'll start at the beginning here. This is where we should start, right? 2015.
Kind of. This was when I first really started taking photos, like not seriously, but I really was dedicating all of my spare time to like planning shoots with my friends and trying to figure out a style. And I mean, film was so much cheaper back then. It was only like 7 years ago, but we used to be able to get film for £1 a roll from Poundland. And so whenever I saw it, I would just bulk buy like as many of them as I could. And then that would like set me for like some months straight. And then it was kind of cheaper to develop as well. But now Poundland doesn't sell it. So it's like the cheapest you can get is like £8 a roll now, which is such a
That's
crazy difference. Like,
yeah, that is inflation for you. And for developing too, like, do you develop your own film or did you have it sent out? Like, how did you deal with
So
that?
in 2015, I used to get it developed at like Boots, which is a drugstore here. They used to do it for like £6 a roll, which was kind of cheap. You could get a CD with the prints on as well as the physical print, so it was really good. Like, and they do it within an hour. But then they stopped doing that a few years ago. But when I moved to London in 2014 for a year or two, there's several labs around London, and the one I used quite a lot was eye culture, and you could pay like £3 or maybe it was £4, and they develop the roles over a week, so it'd be kind of like a long turnaround, but then it was a good way to do it and save money. And now I kind of use, it depends on the project. Like if it's a commercial job, I'll use one of the kind of more, I don't know, more expensive, like higher scan quality labs. But otherwise I just use the cheap places because I don't have the money to do personal projects on like £20 a roll developing.
Yeah, so let me ask you, like, right off the bat then, this is 2015, which is not really all that long ago. And there were, I'm trying to think back to then, but I know that there are like plenty of apps. Instagram is one of them that can just like use filters to give you the look of like Kodachrome or some of these old film stocks. Like, what drove you to like go back to film and not use like digitized versions of these things?
I think my love for it started through so in 2008 to 2009 I used Flickr all of the time and like
That's okay.
found loads of inspiration from photographers on there, and then I moved to Tumblr because I realized that was kind of where a lot of the younger artists were as well, and just found that most of the stuff I was reblogging or like taking an interest in was all shot on film. And so we're quite lucky because we have a family friend who used to work at Kodak, and I think he gave me his Rolleiflex to test for like a couple of months, and so I shot a few things with that and was like, wow, this is really, really cool. But that's medium format film, so it was always kind of like more expensive. But then another one of our family friends had just this like Minolta 35mm camera lying around that he let me borrow to take to, I think I took it to New York on a school trip in like 2012. And just the way the pictures looked, like when they came back, I was like, that the tones on it, I just found like I couldn't really
It's
replicate it.
seductive.
Yeah,
It's
exactly.
seductive. It's so funny you mentioned this. We didn't talk about this before, but I'm actually from Rochester, New York, which is where Kodak was
Oh,
created.
cool.
So, and I started taking photographs when I was like 8 years old. Very similar story. I owned a Rolleiflex and fell in love with medium format. It's all like it's very parallel situation.
Oh, cool. Yeah,
Yeah,
it's my
just like,
favorite, one of my favorite cameras now. It's so good.
yeah, oh yeah. And I had my first 35 millimeter camera was a Minolta, like an SRT
Oh
101, I think, or an
my
SR101 or whatever it is, which is so weird that
God.
we're
Yeah, that's
just,
crazy.
yeah, it's weird. So this is like a commercial job, right? Can you talk about this a little bit?
Yeah, so basically what I did in 2015, I was working at Tesco, which is a supermarket here, and all of my spare time that I wasn't at work, I was kind of planning shoots or editing photos or like trying to just like immerse myself as much in it as I could. And then I basically would post, so my shifts were 3 p.m. till midnight, and my breaks, I would take them and post one picture on Instagram at like 6 p.m. Then I'd post again later in the evening at like 9, which now seems like so, like, why would you do that? Like, who would post on Instagram twice a day? Like, it just seems very mad. But like back then, it was kind of how I started to build a following. And then by the end of 2015, I had like a fair few thousand followers. And someone emailed me and were like, oh, I want to pitch you for this job with Adidas. Like, would you be cool with that? And I was like, well, yeah, obviously. Like, it would be amazing. And then yeah, then I ended up getting it, which was really cool because it was like my first ever commercial job. And I remember I was away with my auntie for her birthday at the time, and they sent me what my fee would be, which was like €2,000. And I showed it to my auntie and I was like, oh my God, I can't believe it. Like, this is, do you think this is my fee, or do you think this is what it will be for the whole shoot, like that we have to spend on film and stuff like that? And then when I checked with who was like managing the project, they were like, no, that's just your fee. And I was like, oh my God, that is like, I don't know, it was, yeah, a crazy amount of money
A
to
real
be like,
job.
yeah. And so I don't know, looking back on it now, I feel like I just went into it so naively, like I really had no clue what I was doing, but some of the jobs worked and they were happy with them in the end, so it was good. But
I mean, you say you don't have a clue what you're doing, but then I'm just like looking at your composition techniques, just and they're pretty striking, and
oh, thanks.
they tell a story. There's movement in them. I mean, you seem to have like a natural inclination for it all.
Thank
Just like
you.
telling a story with your work. So tell us about these.
Well, the bottom left picture is my friend Ione, and she runs polyester zine. She I don't know if you've heard of it, but she is like the editor of the magazine, like made it as a university project and then continued it afterwards. And that night we went to this, we hadn't been friends for very long, but there was a night at this pub in East London, and they were doing a night especially dedicated to Hole, and which is like Courtney Love's band. And when we first met, we kind of like bonded over loving that group so much. And so I was like, oh, we should go. And we went, and it was just completely a flop. Like, there was hardly anyone there. But as you walk down the stairs, like into where the night was, that's where this like red light picture was. And I was like, oh, wait there, because she had red hair at the time as well. So it just was like, I just wanted to take that picture.
It's a decisive moment. Yeah,
Yeah, I
I
really
love
like
it.
it. I hadn't seen it for ages. Then I was putting this together and I was like, oh, I really forgot about that photo, but I do really like it.
Yeah.
And then the next one was just, yeah, that was just like a, I think for,
Oh,
I used to do a lot of, if people would just message me on Instagram and be like, hey, do you want to shoot this kind of thing for our magazine? Even if it didn't, wasn't, you know, money or there was no budget or anything, I'd often do it just to be working. And that was something to do with one of those shoots, but I just really liked, I was obsessed with roses so much. I'm not really very anymore, but.
Well, I noticed there's like a lot of work. I mean, we'll get into more of your work, but this flowers kind of pop up a lot in your work, which I think, I mean, for me, it's sort of like all part of this like nostalgic, and I want to ask you a question about this later, but like this tension between being very nostalgic of past, eras, where, there's hyper femininity and there's very stringent separation between genders, like the gender binary is very strong and represented in these nostalgic, these aesthetics. But then, like your work, especially like what we're looking at right now, is like kind of bucks the trend or sort of reconfigures some of the things we think about when we think about like nostalgia and gender roles. You're kind of like breaking that at the same time as you're paying homage to it. I just think that's really interesting. But so this is your first solo exhibition, right? This.
This was the end of, well, it was September 2016, and ID Magazine were doing something like in sponsorship with made.com, who make all the furniture. And again, they emailed me and were like, oh, we want to pitch you as one of the people to maybe do this exhibition, would you be interested? And I was like, well, yeah, I hadn't had a I'd had pieces I think in group shows, but like not proper group shows. It was kind of like I'd print the image myself and then take it. It would never be framed or anything because I just never had the money to make it look amazing. So this was like the first time I ever had it kind of paid for me, and then, you know, like I just went and shot the photos there, and it was good. But I would, this is always one of the things I look back on and wish I would have stood up for what I wanted to shoot more at the time, because when we were pitching it, or like when we were talking about what we'd shoot, I wanted kind of like, I was obsessed with that millennial pink background at the time, and really just wanted that as like the backdrop. And then when I got there, or I think it was the day before I got there, they sent me pictures of them setting up the studio bit where we'd shoot, and it was that background that's in the two images. And I was like, I really don't like it, but I didn't say anything because I was like, well, this is an opportunity that like I'm really grateful for, and I didn't want to risk not being able to do it or like seem bratty. And so I just went with it, but now I wish I would have just like said something.
Yeah, that's funny. That's so that kind of gets to one of my questions about here, because this I was like reading a little bit about the exhibition here, and it says one of the things is like the main goal is to capture the essence, and I'm quoting here, of what it means to be a strong woman in just one shot. I think, creating a single composition that embodies the strength of women is a challenge. It's like extremely challenging, especially in light of what we're talking about, right? Where women are often used as objects of desire, or they're looked at, and the passivity is really like the is the point of a lot of images of women, that they're passive and objects, right? So my question to you is, can you share some of your strategies? Like, how did you, with when you had this challenge, like what kind of strategies did you have to capture the strength?
Well, I mean, I hadn't read the middle bit for ages, literally since I was there. So I didn't realize it said in just one shot. But I mean, in a way, that's kind of misleading because we did shoot loads, like, but it was selected one final image, which I guess also is what the majority of my work is like. Like, I'll show one image on my Instagram, but then behind that is a roll of 24 that, didn't get used. But also, I think, especially with this shoot, I didn't really direct the models so much. I just kind of let them do what they wanted to do, which I think in a way is kind of how
Interesting.
you get people to look more natural in themselves. Because I don't know, it kind of works both ways, actually. Some people do really prefer to be directed because they don't feel comfortable, especially if they're not models. But I think because this was kind of a submission to be the model thing, like they had to apply via ID, I think, at the time. So I think the people who applied kind of already had some kind of confidence that they wanted to model and things like that. So it was kind of easier to capture, to like get good portraits of these
Interesting.
people, I think. But it is quite hard.
I can, I mean, I wouldn't be able to. I don't think I could do it. I'm not equipped to do it, I don't think. So I just found that really interesting. So tell us about these two pieces.
So 2017, I was still getting a few commercial jobs, but nothing major, like nothing big money. I think I was at university, but I wasn't really going. So I was just using my student loan money to enable me to live in London, and be able to do photography, because that's what I wanted to do. And the course I was on wasn't really to do with that. It was to do with like, I wanted to do sound design for TV and like the soundtracks and things, but I just never went, so
Interesting.
I never learned anything. But the image on the left was when I stayed at my friend's house while she was on a holiday, and she's a photographer and had like all of her studio equipment in her house. So I completely utilized that and shot like at least two or three people every day while I was staying there, just to try and build up like. Just, I don't know, I guess in a way I was always kind of practicing, like trying to keep it going and like trying to get good portraits and trying to have, in a way, I suppose, what you'd call now like content to share, I guess, but also because I wanted to do it and not just because I felt like it's what I should be doing. It was like I just didn't really want to do anything else at the time. And then 2017 was also when I kind of really started to try and collage images a lot. I mean, this one is very basic, like it's just a lot of cut out images that I printed off, and then I think I had a lot of floral magazines left over from something I made for my grandparents' Christmas present. So a lot of the background images are kind of from that. And then I think a lot of my work has themes of like longing, like I was always kind of desperate for certain things and really wanted a relationship and really wanted to be in love. And I mean, you can tell by the writing that's all over it. It's all song lyrics and not really ever things I made up. But then I always kind of wrote what resonated with me at the time, because it was like cathartic. I wasn't really doing it to be like, I don't know, manifesting. It was more like, I need to get this out because it's just staying in me.
I mean, I noticed this a lot in your work, that you seem to have like instincts for stuff. Right. And this is one of the questions that I had, and I guess I can just ask now. So we were talking before this about your educational background, and you didn't go to art school, right? Like you sort of organically. So
Well,
my question.
I kind of did. I just, dropped out three
So, but I
times.
think, so one thing, so I think that's really fascinating because you're clearly an established and accomplished artist. Even, you have a career, you're getting jobs, you're getting work, you have instincts that you can trust. I mean, it's like really amazing and inspiring, which is one of the reasons I want to talk to you, right? But one thing I kind of regret about going to art school is that I learned to constantly question my instincts, or another way to put it is I unlearned to trust them. Right before I went to art school, I thought I was like going to change the art scene, and I just trusted what I did, and I could just stay up at night making work and never really questioning it. And I thought it was awesome. And some of it may have been creative, and maybe like there's that top 1% that I could have run with. And you know, it might have been because I went to a design school, which is like, I don't know what it's like in the UK, but in the US, there are design schools, which is a type of art school, right? You get an MFA or a BFA. And then there are art schools, which you could, is, you know, might have design as a curriculum. And in design, though, like, and this is where we're talking, you know, having a design discussion, there's like, you're taught to consider the user, right? To identify certain objectives for your design and design a path toward those objectives. This is just the design process, you know, et cetera. It's very prescriptive. And as a result, I came out of it and I lost some of those instincts that I had as an artist earlier before I even had a career or an education. So can you talk about the importance of trusting your instincts as an artist and maybe like a little bit about how our students who are getting an arts education can hold on to those instincts through, you know, through the process of getting a degree?
Yeah, I mean, I think part of where I struggled was when I, so the first time I did my course, it was magazine publishing, which was in a way useful because then I learned how to, I learned InDesign, which then helped with like making zines and books further down the line, but also I didn't need to pay £9,000 to learn that. Like I could have just learned that online for free. And then I did a different course for a year because I didn't like the other one. And then on that course, I spent all my time in the dark room downstairs because it was in the room opposite, even though I wasn't doing photography. And I was like, well, I'll just go and switch to photography because part of the reason I'd avoided studying it at university was because I didn't want it to take the kind of love or fun out of it. And then the reason I didn't really enjoy that course so much when I did join the photography one was because I was in a like in a class with people who hadn't even heard of like film before or like really basic terminology. And I just thought, which is fine, but also, I mean, if you're studying at university or college level, I feel like you should have some kind of like basic knowledge. I don't know. And it just felt like the work the teachers wanted you to be making was very generic and very like stark images of buildings or just not really letting students, I don't know, follow what they wanted to create, or believing that subverting the like conventional gaze and things like that was something that was worth pursuing. So I think advice-wise, I think inherently you'd know if something felt wrong to you, or if a like teacher is trying to give you advice that you don't really want to take. I mean, I guess it's hard because I don't know how much you're able to fight back against that and say like, actually, no, I don't want to listen to you. I'm going to make my work anyway. But past a degree, like that will be what you have to do to survive authentically as an artist. Like I really wish I'd have stood up for my work and not caved in a lot more than I did end up doing. And I think that also comes with age and like just getting more confident. But it's, I don't know, it is quite a tough, it's a tough one to answer because it's also a tough one to like live. And I still feel like even now there's times where I'm like, I should have just said no to that job, or like, I don't know, it's hard. It's quite, yeah,
I mean,
especially.
I think this is really related to the role of women in our society, right? And how they're traditionally supposed to, it's about being passive, right? It's like part of being accepted, and I'm not a woman, so I can't, you know, I'm just gleaning this from my experience, where everything I do as a white cisgender male is fine. I can do whatever I want. My motivations and my instincts are always trusted. All the doors are open for me, right? That's not true for women. And I think this is very, or traditionally, and I think this is very much related to the gaze, right? The male gaze. So I think it's like an interesting thing. I think, you know, in my classroom, hopefully my students, I give them advice all the time, but I'm very open to like, you know, I give the advice, but then feel free to do the exact opposite. Like that's really, you know, I suppose like that mirrors what you were saying. I want to talk about this, these two pictures, the but there's a, we have a question, and I also just want to pause just to let everyone know that they can ask questions while we're talking in the Q&A section module that's right at the bottom of your screen in Zoom here. But we have a question from Andrea. She's asking, when you are taking posed photos, Do you have a process you use to talk to subjects before you start shooting? What do you say?
Okay, so most of the people I've ever really shot with that aren't models have been my friends, or we've become friends before we started shooting. So I feel like it's always been quite easy to compose shots or ask them to pose. I would sometimes just say, like, oh, put your hand there, or like, look at me, or close your eyes, or like very like minimal direction, I guess. Just because I think the people I chose to shoot with always had something that I wanted to kind of capture. And the more that you direct them, I guess sometimes you can kind of lose that. But then, I mean, I think as long as you're comfortable with each other, it makes it easy to talk to each other as, like, I don't know, subject and photographer, because they would always feel well, they'd always kind of pitch ideas to me and be like, oh, should we go over there, shoot here, or in this bit and stuff. And
Sure.
I mean, yeah, I think
you're collaborating with them in a
simple,
way.
Yeah.
And do you shoot a lot of Polaroid? I mean, I noticed, I mean, you're talking about other film stock, but I noticed Polaroids are popping up as well. I love Polaroids.
Me too. I really love Polaroid. When I was shooting in 2015, I couldn't really afford them. They're still expensive now, but I have a load of like stock that I was sent a while ago that I haven't really shot Polaroids in like a few years, so I don't even know if the stock is still going to be in good condition, because I haven't kept it refrigerated or anything. But I love Polaroids, because shooting film, you have to kind of be patient and then wait and take the film, get it developed, and then you get the prints or the emailed scans back to you. And so, like, you really can't see what you've shot and just have to, like, trust yourself for a little bit. But with Polaroids, it's almost instant. And I know there's, like, Fujifilm, which is a cheaper alternative, but the ratio on the frames and stuff, I just could never really get into it as much. Whereas Polaroids feel so, like, inherently reminiscent of the era that I loved the art from, so it really grew attached to Polaroids.
Yeah, I am exact same way, and I love how it has it. It's not like, it's funny because it's to like a professional photographer by the book, it is not a good film stock, right? It's like not. It's like it really like doesn't have really good depth of field.
Yeah,
like the cameras themselves have horrible, non-existent. It's just the whole thing is in focus, and the color representation is kind of bad sometimes. There's little mistakes, like with the way the emulsion develops, can introduce a lot of mistakes. But that's also like again about instincts. It's like that unexpected stuff is sometimes the best, I think. So what's and this the thing on the image on the right? What is this we're looking at? This
Polyesterzine, who Ione was in that red photo, this is her magazine. And then that year I shot the cover. I started working with them loads just because we were friends, and like they had a great platform. It kind of really introduced me to feminism. Like I had obviously been aware of it and read certain things about it, but polyester really kind of blew my mind, like really changed my worldview when I met Ione in 2016, and just opened up like the way I started to shoot. I feel like my work before was very conventional, and even though I was shooting film and still trying to take images that weren't completely like conventional, a lot of my models were, you know, fit within very like narrow beauty standards and things, and even though they were my friends and stuff. But after 2017, my work kind of really started to, like, I don't know, I think branch out a bit. And then I mean, yeah, this was, so I had that exhibition in Berlin, which was a solo exhibition, but because it was also in collaboration with like a brand and a magazine, I didn't really have much say. Whereas this one, I wanted to do a solo exhibition that I had like full control over, and I had no money, so I had to find a venue that was free in London, which was like really, really hard to do. And this venue was basically, you can kind of see the roof, which was it was basically four walls that were just put up inside this huge, huge, huge office building. And then that's okay. And then the roof was just like, I guess, put on top to make it seem like it was a closed gallery space. And it was way out. It was like on the DLR line, which is like further than the overground. So it was really far in East London. But the opening night was really busy. And it was my 21st birthday, so I wanted to like curate
Wow.
an exhibition to do with that. And I just, yeah, it was a lot of my past work and a lot of like what was meaningful to me. There's like pictures of my family. I mean, I don't know why the Elvis record was there. I think that was probably just like aesthetically pleasing, but it was just kind of like, I don't know, all the things that I'd liked over the years and sort of like a burst of my Instagram on
Yeah.
in the exhibition. I had big ideas for it, but I didn't have budget. So I wanted to do like fences and picket fences and have like, I wanted it to be way better, but I had to print cheaply and
Yeah.
do it as like cheaply as I could. But that
But
was
there's
some of
something, I think that's why I dig it, because it's kind of like there's this naivete about it, that this could be, you know, that this could be a teenage girl's bedroom wall, right? It has like, you know, it has that aesthetic and it has that sort of composition and the thematic nature of it. It's and
And
its
I think at
nostalgia
the
or something.
time, because I was turning 21, it was like me saying goodbye fully to like that part of my life, which, yeah, I guess kind of is, yeah, was right at the time.
That's interesting. Let me zoom out here again. Okay. Now we're ready to go to these. So tell me about these two works here.
So in 2018, I've always kind of wanted to do videos, but I stayed with photography because it was easier to control in a way. Like I felt like it was easier to get a still image that I really liked than a video. And also money-wise, like shooting on video film was just way, way more expensive than photo film. So it just always felt quite out of reach.
Yeah.
And then I did a commercial job, and I think that was again paid like £1,500. So I was like, okay, with this money, I want to put it towards trying to make a film and have something to show or like add to my portfolio. And so that was what A Much Better Illusion was. And it was shot just like over 3 days. I took my car and Sylvie. We kind of shot in London and then went to the beach. There's no like meaning to it. It was just, I don't know, it does feel a bit derivative when I watch it now, and like of like Jean-Luc Godard and things like that, but like at
Right. Right. Well,
the
I was
time,
gonna let me bring it up because I was also gonna mention it kind of reminds me of like Warhol's work. Like he did these. Let me just make sure. Yeah, I'm sharing the sound. Yeah. Let me just bring it up here and
Thank you.
So I love that. I love that piece. I get the Godard reference now, and I can see that. But I think it was the Velvet Underground that like sort of threw me towards Warhol. But you know, it kind of reminds me of Warhol's Screen Test. You know, like he did like East Sedgwick and Billy Naim and Paul America and like all these guys. And so I wanted to ask you, like, how much are you influenced by Warhol's work, and I guess also Godard's work? Does it sort of like factor it? Because both of those are, they're both men, and you know, they're very much a part of this male gaze tradition. What do you think about this? Like, how are you positioned in relation to them?
I think at the time of making that and the years kind of between 2017 and 2018, when I really was like trying to get into the 60s aesthetic, or like it was what I was most drawn to and what I wanted to recreate almost, like all of the work I loved most seemed to be from that time. So I was kind of watching a lot of films from then and the 70s, and then it didn't really matter if they were like male or female or like whoever. It kind of was the look of things that I was drawn to. I mean, a lot of the meanings have probably gone over my head from like some of the films I've watched and things, but it was always the look that I felt most compelled by and wanted to kind of like be inspired by for that film. But I think, I mean, yeah, I really do like some of Warhol's work. I think he himself was like a really troubled individual as well, and his kind of like view, his view on everything, as well as being an outsider who was like desperately lonely, like really, yeah, I don't know. I do kind of
I
see.
wanted, I mean, about that, I mean, he was really known for, especially in film, but also like in his still work, like in his like screen prints, he's really known for highlighting iconic but often really tragic women, right? So like Edie Sedgwick, Marilyn Monroe, Jackie Onassis. So I guess my question is, in your own work, in your own filmmaking, how do you sort of work with this tension between celebrating like this, the allure of your subjects, right? The seduction of them, with also some of the challenges they may face as women, especially through, as we're talking about the male gaze. Like, how do you sort of address this?
I don't know if I ever really have like consciously thought about it, like with a much better illusion. I think the kind of rough premise of it was that Sylvie was always going to be the person. We were like really good friends at the time and collaborated all the time, so she was always going to be the person I wanted to like make my first kind of thing with. But she wrote the lines that are in it. She writes poetry and like she just has really good views on things, and so I kind of always wanted that side of her to also be like shown within it. But I think when I've shot with other people, especially if they've like been famous or anything, I think it's more just trying to capture them in a way that I guess seems authentic, but also just through what I see through the viewfinder looks good. I don't know if I'm ever trying to do it in like a specific way. It's always been like the look of the images, I guess, that mattered most, which is maybe like a bit of a, I don't know, sadistic thing to say, or like, I don't know.
No, I don't know. I mean, it goes back to my question about instinct. I mean, you're again, this whole idea of reframing the gaze and these sort of this intersectional issues about women in society, these are like really great things to talk about, very theoretical and philosophical. But like when you're making work, I don't know if that is the time to think about those things consciously, because you're working on a different level at that point, like a subconscious level, right?
I think so. And I mean, I think now the work I make or that I want to make is kind of a lot more driven by, I suppose, a kind of like rage, or not necessarily like female rage, but just like rage in general, or I guess the yearning that I used to have. I kind of got to the stage where I had what I was always yearning for, and then that didn't really work out so well either. And now it's more of like a different kind of yearning that's the other side of that, that's more, like rage fueled and filled and whatever. But I think the work I make going forward we'll probably have some kind of conscious, just because I'm different now, I suppose, and your life experiences do kind of influence you, whether you realize it or not, I guess. So I think back then it was fine making work that was like a bit prettier or carried less of a meaning. But also then it's kind of always a bit obvious when people are making work with a meaning just for the sake of like making a point. And then I think that's also not authentic either. So it's quite difficult to fully balance, I suppose.
I can totally understand that. I mean, I think that's kind of what I mean. It's like I feel like I was able to do that at one point, and then I went to graduate school, and then I suddenly lost the ability for subtlety and elegance. And I had to like fight back to get any of it, and only recently now am I able to really, I
Yeah,
think, do that. It
it's
just
really hard.
Yeah, you just seem to have an alacrity for it, I guess. I
Oh,
guess is
thanks.
my point. So this piece, one other question about the all of this work is, when you're shooting on Super 8, which is fabulously expensive, as I can attest to, how do you edit? Do you do the editing?
So the one before,
Yeah, this
that
much better
was
illusion.
a mix of 8mm and 16, just because I'd never ever shot 16 mil, and a lot of the films I'd watched from the 60s were shot on 35, and I was like, well, I'm never going to be able to shoot that. So 16 was the next best kind of thing. And then at the time, I ha didn't have an agent, or anyone like industry-wise contact that would have like helped out. But then Sasha, who is still my kind of, she's my producer but also kind of an agent, she asked to meet with me just before I shot this, and then I think she gave me like £200 towards film costs, and also then put me in touch with Ben Crook, who edited the film, because I started editing it myself, and then I was like, I'm not an editor, like there's something I'm missing, and doesn't feel right to put out this just because there was something missing. So she got Ben to have a look at it, and then I sat with him in the studio for the first time like that I'd ever been in an edit suite, and it was really cool. His kind of take on it, he helped bring kind of more of a like psychedelic aspect to it, I guess, like the bit at the end where all the screen testy bits kind of all merged together. And then the voicemail bits where the like music stops, and then he was just, yeah, quite influential on that. And but this one was basically shot for Straight Eight, which is a kind of competition where loads of directors will shoot a roll of Super 8 film, and then you send it off to them, and then that gets premiered. You're not allowed to see it, edit it, or do anything to it. And you have no idea if it's worked out. Like in this bit,
That's
there's a couple
cool.
of seconds where it goes completely black, and it's because I had no idea like that I'd flicked something wrong on the camera. So the first time you see it is at the premiere with like all of the other people. So you have, it's quite like nerve-wracking.
That's amazing. Let's play this though,
It
because
was
I
really
found
fun, yeah.
this really interesting too, and it kind of harkens back to a different era of like London, a little bit later than the 60s, I found. One Super 8 cartridge, no editing,
Yeah,
right?
no editing.
Wow.
Suppose I want to talk about being remaining quietly smug, like I've caught the big house out, and like I'm watching it as much as it's watching me. And like the breath that exits my mouth as I laugh is enough to blow it all away, which is even just for a moment. But I want to talk about that moment from all angles. And I want to talk about watching, like how we all just watch each other like it's television. And we give ourselves the right to control and to judge. Obviously, some of us more than others. The main thing I want to talk about is the taking, because I need to. Because I'm on the floor and it's jealousy that put me there and paints over my tag. I want to talk about cruelty and lack of empathy, entitlement and greed. I want to talk about understanding the silence of that. because I need to, again, for protection, and understanding the smugness as that protection and a sword and a shield. But smugness is the moment when the penny drops and when it gets cold. Like, how does one articulate a noise that can't be heard? Not really. Not nicely, not with ease. Because my practice has been swallowed by a diaspora. I've been trying to untangle like an old gold chain passed down through generations. Like, I've come through my white mom and my black dad, and I hope to one day arrive at me, but looking for me is sticky. Being mixed race feels like fire and water all at once, because it is, isn't it? I'm a product of black and white working class Britain, and I can taste it in my fists and in my heart. This is why I'm an artist, because I can do like nothing but just feel it. Like a true Cancerian. My body holds that war inside it.
I mean, for me, it's those black and some in some cases underexposed areas that really sell it to me. Like, it really balances the piece, because the piece has like a natural pacing. It's really well paced, and it's, it has flowers in it and a happy subject. She's dancing around, and then like you hit these little spots that are underexposed, which kind of obscures the gaze, right, on by design. And that's why I think it's like a really powerful piece. You're and I know this is true about a lot of, I mean, most of your work. You really like heavily lean into nostalgia in your work, and we were talking about this before. And in this case, like in this particular piece, Mug, you're kind of like, it feels like mid-70s, mid to late 70s, maybe early 80s London, like punk scene, if I had to like throw in a name around, if I had to throw a noose around the aesthetic that you're going for, right? So, and then in the previous piece, it's like 60s new wave, right? But at the same time, I think, you're leaning into these nostalgia, but you're also encouraging us to question certain assumptions that those different time periods held about the role of women in society, right? And I guess my question to you is, how do you want your audience to engage with this juxtaposition, right? Of what kind of conversations or reflections do you want them to have about the traditional role of women and this new emerging role of women, where they're a little bit more where they're more active, they're the heroes in their own story. Like, those things are kind of at odds in some way, and I think you have a really good way of addressing it. Could you just like talk about that and what you want your audience to come away with?
Yeah, I mean, I think with Smug, Rini, who is in the film and then also is the voiceover, a lot of her work around that time, and I mean still now, was to do with like skinhead culture, because there's links to it in her family. And so it kind of, we wanted to shoot it around that, but also it's kind of like a difficult subject, because there's a lot of skinhead culture that's so heavily towards violence and things like that, that I think in Rini's work she explores so well. And it's kind of what's difficult with romanticizing so much like past eras, because in like historic context there's such dark like undertones going on beneath that, especially, well, I mean, as far as you go back in history, there's always some kind of horrible stuff going on underneath. And I think, I don't know, I don't know if I've ever really, I don't know, because I feel like I'm quite guilty of romanticizing it and using it in my imagery and like trying to be inspired by it. But then also, I don't know if I've ever really thought, like, is it actually, I don't know, does it serve a purpose, or is it just because it looks a certain way? I mean, I think like Chantal Ackerman did such a good job of kind of like subverting the traditional, like housewife values or something, or something like that, whilst also making like beautiful, beautiful work and like with really heavy meanings. But I think I don't know, I guess I would hope that an audience would take away, or maybe it would just question, or like question whether it's something that they could visualize in that time. Like, could they visualize Rini running around in a state, cutting Union Jack flags with a skinhead badge on, like in the 80s? Would that be something that was possible? Probably not. Like, or would it be, I don't know. I mean, I guess Sylvie's situation in A Much Better Illusion kind of is easy to assume that that would happen, because you know she's just someone in a house, or like in a nature situation. But I think the work I want to make going forward would probably confront that a bit more in a way, or like maybe showing it in more of a messy way than this romantic like aesthetic that's very pastel and quite pleasing, whereas I want to delve more into like madness and a lot more darker like themes, just because that's, I don't know, what kind of is drawing to me at the moment, or like drawing me to it.
I think that's, I mean, that's kind of incredible. I mean, and again, like, I think, you know, our whole conversation, I'm like asking you to like divulge stuff about your process. And I think your process, what I'm gleaning, is that it's largely instinctual and subconscious. And I, you know, and I feel like you should keep it that way. Like, right? I don't want to, you know, I don't think you should be like questioning anything. And that's my whole point. Like, don't do what I did, which was like go down this academic path where you're like teasing out every philosophical existential argument about why you make work. You shouldn't do that as an artist, right? But I think I'm just kind of interested because like your work is so beautifully nostalgic, and you just like you really capture those time periods so well. I'm just kind of interested like how you feel about it. And I guess I am kind of interested also what comes next like for you. And I thought maybe like we could just quickly, we have like about 5 minutes left. I wanted to talk about your Instagram feed, which is just on point. I mean, I really, that's like this, by the way, like was the thing, this was the thing that like made me, when I was like researching you, I saw some of your exhibition work. I'm like, yeah, this is cool. But then I saw your Instagram feed and it's
Oh,
just
cool.
like, it's beyond. I mean, I just am really into it. And you have
Thanks.
like this, like the film stock look. It looks like high fashion, right? In a way, like it's sort of like low res, high fashion aesthetic. But it's just so cool. And I was just kind of thinking, could you talk about it a little bit? Like what you're like, it kind of stands as a portfolio in a way, right?
Especially when I was first starting out, Instagram was kind of the only place I would constantly post my work. I mean, I did have a website. It was a cargo collective website that is quite good for like starting out and uploading projects. But then Instagram really became the place where I was connecting with people and just shared like as much as I possibly could on there. And I think I used to share a lot of personal stuff on there. Like, I used to post kind of Tumblr posts with like captions that were to do with how I was feeling at the time. And then I kind of tried to reel that back and just post like things related to work, or I guess books now, since I've been working in the bookshop and stuff. I also try and share a lot of inspiration, like, or mood board images on there, because part of what drew me to art and photography was Tumblr. And that was like, because it was just one big place where you could curate this self. And I guess that's kind of what I do on Instagram, I suppose, as well.
It's kind of how it reads. It's like you're using it in an interesting way as like a tool, I think. I mean, this is what I'm getting from it.
It's
To
kind of
curate,
different post-COVID,
I mean, it's, but it's like who you are as an artist, partly, which is sort of what a portfolio is for, but it's also like bleeding into who you are as a person. And I don't know, I just think it's really cool. There's just like lots of cool stuff on here. It's very body positive, very sex positive. It bleeds
I
into
think
like
'cause at
family,
the time that was very much like what the meanings were kind of like behind my work. I was trying to kind of open it up past a certain, past like the conventions that I spoke of before. But then I don't know, I just shared loads of stuff on there, to be fair.
And this is really interesting. This is a commercial project you had, right?
Yeah, it was my first directing project and it was right before COVID. So it kind of should have probably been the start of like doing loads of video stuff. And then
Yeah.
COVID happened and like it, yeah, my life completely changed after that, as did loads of people's. But this was, yeah, it was kind of fun to shoot. This was it was a advert for like a period company.
Right.
But it was kind of like a jokey take, and they let me use like the vintage wallpaper as the background, and like it was kind of fun because I think what's nice about commercial stuff now is people come to, or like people offer me jobs because they want that kind of look. So I kind of don't feel as bad leaning into that like
No, I
vintage
don't.
look anymore, because
Nuh-uh.
that's kind of, I guess, what my Instagram shows and what maybe my work is like known for now.
Yeah. I mean, this is cool too because this piece, well, this they're looking at women's
Yeah.
products, right?
Yeah, the concept was kind of fun. I think that's what drew me to it. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's very much related to this idea of the female gaze too,
Yeah.
and you know, period products like the pink tax, like all the stuff that kind of like
Yeah.
goes into the stuff we're talking about. And I'm just gonna, you know, I'll put up your account. I'll just drop this in the chat. But anybody who wants to follow you can do that. I mean, I highly recommend it. It's pretty amazing your work.
Thank
Chloe,
you.
thank you so much for meeting with me and talking with us. It's been really cool talking to
Well,
you.
thank you for having me.
Yeah, thank you so much. And if anybody has any questions for you, I assume they can get in touch with you via
Yeah,
Instagram. Is
yeah.
that was that like a
DM
cool way
me
to
or
do it?
email me. That's probably the best
Awesome.
ways.
Awesome. All right. Thank you so much, Chloe. I hope you have a
Thank
good
you.
weekend.
You too. Bye.
All
Bye,
right.
everyone.
Bye-bye.